इन द नेम ऑफ अल्लाह हु इज़ द मोस्ट बेनिफिशेंट एंड द मोस्ट मर्सीफुल। अस्सलामु अलैकुम। लॉन्ग डेज जर्नी इनटू नाइट, नन इज टू ब्लेम फॉर द टायरॉन फैमिलीज वोज बिकॉज सेल्फ डिस्ट्रक्टिवनेस ब्रॉट डिस्ट्रक्शन फॉर ईच एंड एवरी मेंबर ऑफ द फैमिली। माइकल हिंडन राइटली ऑब्जर्व दैट नथिंग इज टू ब्लेम एक्सेप्ट एवरीबडी। Tyrone's own errors of judgment are responsible for his ruin. Then Mary remained all along the 36 years of her marriage haunted by her baseless whimsicality of homelessness. She never took any step to put her two sons on the right path. So she lost the peace of mind which she could derive from her proper nourishment imparted to them, because the children learn or dislearn from the lap of their mother. Mary never insisted her husband to resort to first class doctors. Her disinterestedness in family decisions and actions kept her a victim of misfortune, so she had to take recourse to morphine addiction to relieve her rheumatic pain. She could either give up her addiction by her strong willpower, or else she could go to some more costly anti-narcotic sanatorium for her permanent treatment. She resumed her dope addiction 2 months after coming from sanatorium. If she could give up morphine for 2 months, she could give it up forever also. So it is she herself who is to blame for her own ruin. Both the sons, Jemmy and Edmund, chose the path of Satan even in their school-going age. Neither of them ever tried to turn back to the right path. Both their father and mother failed to admonish them. Both of them become victims of dipsomania in addition to world wandering. So both Edmund and Jemmy are themselves responsible for their moral and professional decline. Indeed, each of the 4 major characters of this play is responsible for his or her own self-destructiveness. It is advisable to accept Mary's claim that none of us can help avoid the things that life has done to us. It is because the play projects fatalism. We do what fate dictates us to do. Instead of determinism, we may not do what the fate dictates us to do. An insight into the biographical sketches of all the 4 major characters of the play provides many evidences of the supremacy of fatalism. Eugene O'Neill presents in his Long Day's Journey into Night quite imperceptibly Nietzsche's philosophy that life in itself is nothing, and it is the dream that keeps human being fighting, compromising, loving and hating. This nothingness of life is categorically professed for the first time in the play when Edmund observes that his father's lifelong prayers to God could not bring recovery of health for his mother Mary. Quote from Nietzsche's book, God is dead. At this juncture, Edmund's elder brother shrugs his shoulders and thinks that his mother is genuinely the victim of Nietzsche's concept of life's nothingness and universe's uselessness. So he mutters, she will listen but won't listen. She will be here but she won't be here. His father, Tyrone Howard, is the only character in the play who is the staunch opponent of such a philosophy, which he condemns as the exponent of pessimism. Edmund indeed finds out in Nietzsche's philosophy a source for his spiritual escape when he says, the fog was where I wanted to be. I could not see but a few feet ahead. I did not meet a soul. Everything looked and sounded unreal. Nothing was what it is. That is what I wanted, to be alone with myself in another world where truth is untrue and life can hide from itself. I even lost the feeling of being on land, as if I was a ghost belonging to the fog, and the fog was the ghost of the sea. Nothing more than a ghost within a ghost, like a corpse. Who wants to see life as it is, if they can help it? Life is the three horrifying women in one. You look in their faces and turn to stone, or it is Pan, ugly shaped shepherd god. You see him and you die inside you and have to go on living as a ghost.